use the word ain't. Hey, man, it is so good to see y'all here today. Thank y'all so very much. And that is so true. There's not anyone that's ever going to love us like Jesus loved us. Is that not true? Say amen. I'd like to hear the word amen every once in a while. Thank you for that. Let's pray. Dear precious Heavenly Father, Lord, how good it is to be in your house today. How good it is to be around Christians, dear precious Heavenly Father, brothers and sisters in Christ. And Lord, we just thank you for your love and how much you do love us. Lord, I don't think that we really appreciate just what you did for us. And dear precious Heavenly Father, the love that you showed for us. But dear precious Heavenly Father, I thank you for your love. Lord, again, I just thank you for this church. I thank you for its ministry. Dear precious Heavenly Father, all of those that are on the prayer list, we especially pray for the search committee as they're working so diligently to find somebody that is full-time in this church. And we just pray, Lord, that you'll just lead them to that person that needs to be here. Thank you for the things that this church does and its outreach. And good precious Heavenly Father, we praise you for that. In your precious holy name today, we praise you. Amen. It is good to see you here. This is only a sample of what you're going to get tonight if you come, okay? Now, I went to the National Quartet Convention, and that's the way they talk, all right? But it is going to be a great night of fellowship. Going to be a great night of just simply praising the Lord tonight. We hope that you're back. Bring someone with you. Fill this place up. Let's just sing tonight and praise. I'm sure that Melinda will say something more about it in just a little bit. But right now, I just want to kind of remind you of that. Also, before I forget it, you deacons, you will have a short meeting immediately following church today. So you do remember that. And I'm just back in the library back where y'all meet at. So do remember that. And then on Wednesday, it will be the Young at Heart meeting. I like what was written in here, and I'll have to find it to remember what it was, to be honest with you. But it's October eating meeting. I just like that phrase in that. Yes, I do. In that soup, sandwiches, anything in that line, so you just come at that time that is there. I did notice in this morning, and to be honest with you, did not know whether y'all were involved in it or not, the Samaritan Purse shoe boxes, okay? And that, pack that, I guess some 1st of October, 1st of November, when those are collected, I think, in that. Am I right on that? Okay, so I do remember that. Are there other announcements that I need to make at this time? Then let me read the prayer list for you, okay? John A. Porter, Timothy Blackwell will be having his thyroid. I guess the best word is killed. This week, so do remember him in prayer very much, okay? And of course, Patsy and Boo and Gary, we continue to remember those also in our prayers. Are there others that you need to mention to me at this time? And I know that we have a lot of just illness that is going on, so let's do remember that also. Okay, thank y'all again for being. Again, mind you to be here tonight. It'll be a very special time. Business meeting also following that, so you also remember that. Okay, stand in fellowship with one another.
goodness of that second verse. Holy.
Teach me so. Thank you.
angel told Mary, "You shall call his name Jesus." And it had a special ring to it. Still does it not? Those of us that know Jesus Christ as Savior, and that's what Jesus means, Savior. And he is our Savior. Isn't that a great thing to think about today? That we have a Savior in Jesus Christ. We're in John today, the 5th chapter. And we'll read the first few verses of that. It is a passage, of course, I have to preach passages that are familiar to you, because they have to be familiar to me. And I don't know a whole lot with it. All right? And then you agreed with that. I understand that. Amen. This is a very beautiful passage. John called them signs. In fact, in the book of John, John really portrayed Jesus as God. That's the way he wanted to present it. Now, John wrote his gospel many years after the other gospels were written. That's probably the reason his gospel is so much different than the other. The first three we call synoptic gospels, because they pretty well go along with one another in what is said about Jesus' life, and they talk about Jesus' life and the things that he did. John also does that, but John does it with the purpose of showing that he was the Son of God, that he was God. In fact, if you'll turn over just a minute to the 20th chapter, which would have John really, I think, intended to be the last thing that he wrote, and then he thought about his buddy Peter after that, and he wrote chapter 21. We know that they weren't in chapters back in that time, but he wrote that. But he said this in beginning in the 30th verse, and reading verses 30 and 31. And as he finishes his gospel, he says this, "And truly Jesus did many other signs," and he called them signs, "in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in the book, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ." And Christ simply means the Messiah, the one that was sent from God, the one that was promised. That's the reason when you read the Old Testament, someone once said that it doesn't make any difference where you cut the Bible, it's going to bleed. Everything about the Bible is about Jesus Christ. The Old Testament is about Jesus Christ in that, but in that right there, because he is the promised one that was promised during that time. And John says that that he wrote these that we may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. And there is something magic, I've told you before, about the name of Jesus. There really is. When you talk about Jesus, that's the reason the world today, I think, tries to shut out the name of Jesus. Because there's just something that stirs your soul when you think about Jesus. Today we're going to talk about him, and this is one of the signs. In fact, John records 7 of these signs. And each one of these signs points to something that he wanted to show the world about God, the nature of God, the nature of Jesus Christ. Because you understand that Jesus said, "When you see me, you've seen the Father." In other words, if you want to know what God is really like, you look at the life of Jesus Christ. And you look at the things that Jesus Christ did. And that's what John wanted to show us. And all of these right here are going to point to the very nature of God and the things that God wants to do in our life and the way that God wants to bless us in our life. Today, we begin reading in verse 1 of chapter 5, and it says, "After this, there was a feast of the Jews. And Jesus went up to Jerusalem, and there is in Jerusalem by the sheep gate." And by the way, the sheep gate would have been where they brought in the sacrificial sheep
in there from probably Bethlehem, to be perfectly honest with you, because the shepherds that you hear about during Christmas, the shepherds that were there were probably keeping those sacrificial sheep and raising those, and they would have brought them down, they would have brought them through the sheep gate, and they would have been examined at that point right there for everything that is there. So this is by the sheep gate in that, and it was a pool that is called Bethesda. And it had five porches. And in these lay a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the movement of the water. For an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water, that whoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well of whatever disease he had. Now a certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there, he knew that he already had been in that condition a long time. He said to him, "Do you want to be made well?" The sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up, but while I am coming, another steps down before me." Jesus said to him, "Rise, take up your bed and walk." And immediately the man was made well and took up his bed and walked, and that day was the Sabbath day. Now, when we come to this passage right here, we understand, we see very much the nature of Jesus. We see exactly what Jesus wants to do in our life. For one thing, we understand that Jesus knows everything about us. Jesus had never seen this man before with his physical eyes. And the man had never seen Jesus before, but Jesus knew everything there was to know about him. You know, it's amazing to me because I have tried so often to hide things. And so often we try to hide things and we think that we can hide them from God. You can't hide them from God. God says he sees everything. He knows everything. He knows everything there is to know about us. We don't surprise him with anything that we tell him. We don't surprise him with anything that we confess. He already knows it. He just simply wants us to confess it. He wants us to admit to ourselves, "Yes, Lord, I need you." And this man needed someone. Now, I know a lot of people and a lot of other denominations will tell you that there was a lot of people that was around there that needed healing, and yet Jesus came to this particular man that was there. And some people will tell you, okay, that simply means that God is going to choose somebody to be saved and somebody to be lost. And he talks about predestination. No, predestination has nothing to do with whether we're saved or lost. Predestination is what God wants to do with us, or it's already said in our soul, or in our character, if you would, what he wants to do with us when we come to Jesus Christ. He predestines us to be like him, and we can never become like him if we're lost. So he predestines us to be like him. But I do think that this passage right here shows us the grace and mercy of Jesus Christ. I like the definition that someone once gave about grace. He said, "Grace is given us what we are not given us what we deserve." Grace is not given us what we deserve, because to be perfectly honest with you know as well as I do, if you're a Christian, then what we deserve is God's punishment. What we deserve, we have the nature of Adam in us, and Adam's sin, and we deserve the punishment of God. God doesn't give us that. That's grace. That's the reason I love the song, Amazing Grace, and that's the reason that I think that it was written. Because the man realized, hey, he was a slave trader. He had brought ships back across with people for slaves and that right there. And he realized, hey, listen, I don't deserve the forgiveness of God. But God has forgiven me. And he wrote this great song, Amazing Grace, because of that. Because he understood, hey, listen, God has forgiven me of everything that I have done, and I have failed him. I have sinned so much, and yet God has forgiven me for that. And then mercy is God giving us what we don't deserve. And I think that's what he's showing right here, is in this situation, not that he chose somebody to be saved and me to be lost, but he just simply telling us, hey, listen, I didn't have to save anyone. There was no reason that God would have come down and given his life that I might be part of his family. And no reason for that, except for one thing, and that's the very love of God. Because he loved us. And he didn't have to save us. He didn't have to come and die. In fact, if you read about the garden and that thing, you understand that it was something very painful for him to do. In fact, he prayed so hard until literally drops that looked like blood, that were mixed with blood, really dropped out on the ground at that time, because it was something that he really did not want to face, not as God, not as a human, but especially as God. He did not want to be separated from his Father. He did not want to bear our sins. And he could have. In fact, he told Peter, and he told the other disciples at that point right there, he said, listen, don't you understand that I could call a myriad of angels? I could call thousands of angels, and they would come down and they'd lift me up and they'd take me home. But he did. And I think that's what he shows right here, is that even though he did not have to, and even though there was no reason for him to, he loved us enough that he did. He loved us enough that he did. And I think John wanted to show us in this passage right here just how much God sacrificed for us. So he says in this part right here, he says that he came and he knew. And he knew the sick person. And so, you know, the next thing here, he asked a question. If you look back over here, he says in this right here, let's see if I can find it real quick like, okay? And Jesus knew that he was there, he had been in that condition, and he said to him, this is in verse 5, he said, do you want to be made well? Sound like a stupid question, does it not? The man had been there for 38 years. Probably came or whatever, he probably was crippled or whatever his disease was from a very early age. And he probably really at that point did not know anything else. So Jesus asked him a very pointed question. Do you want your life changed? Because this man's life was fixing to be changed. I mean, it was going to be changed drastically. It was going to be turned upside down, where he was going to be dependent upon other people to bring him there when it was time for that right there, was not going to be, he was not going to be necessary anymore. When it was time for him then to carry him someplace or another, that he would have been begging just simply for a little bit so that he could buy food or do whatever, that wasn't going to be necessary anymore. His life was going to be drastically changed. I think one of the sad things that we see out of this passage is the question that Jesus asked. Because I think he asked us the same question. Do you want God to work in your life? Do you want God to change your life? Oh, sometimes we preachers, we can paint, you come to Jesus, you just go on and do the things that you know. That's not the case. When you come to Jesus, your life is going to change. When you come to Jesus, the Holy Spirit is going to enter your life, and the Holy Spirit is going to begin to work in your life, and the Holy Spirit is going to change that life. Amen. And you know as well as I do, nah, you may not, Brother David, I'm sure, does. Because we go and we visit people, and to be perfectly honest with you, they don't want their life changed. They're into the world and they want to stay into the world. There's not a whole lot that God is going to do with them. There's not a whole lot that God can work with in them. If this man would have simply said, "No, Jesus, I don't," Jesus would have walked off. You remember the rich young ruler? The rich young ruler came to Jesus and he said, "Master." Jesus said, "Why do you call me good?" Or he said, "Good master. Only one is good, and that's God." But he said, What do I need to do?" Because he knew he needed something in his life besides what he had, and he was very rich, but he still needed something in his life. And he said, "What do I need to do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus told him, "And to keep the commandments." And he says, "I've done that," which was not true. But in his mind, he felt like he had. So Jesus said, "Okay, you take your riches and you give it to the poor." And as far as we know, the young man just walked away. Now, you understand this, and I don't want to say this critically or anything else, but the Bible doesn't tell us that Jesus chased after him. Because you understand, if we come to Jesus, we come to him willingly. We come to him recognizing, "Hey, I want my life changed. I want you to alter the things that is inside of me. I have a need down inside of me that I cannot meet, but you can, and I want you to meet that need." We come to him, but we come to him willingly. Last week, we talked about, well, I guess 2 weeks ago, we talked about in the third chapter of the book of Revelations. And Jesus said, "I'm knocking on your door, but you have to open the door." You see, the man had to want something done in his life in order for Jesus to change that life. And I think that's a sad statement. But you know what? God really hit me with a thought this week. Something that I have read this passage. I don't know how many times I read this passage, but it is a thought that never came into my mind as I was reading it. But he pointed it, and probably pointed it directly at me. And I think that it is a sad statement. I've always said the saddest statement in the Bible is found in John 1, where he says that he came unto his own and his own received him not. That to me is one of the saddest statements there is in the Bible. That people that were supposed to know about him rejected him. But I think this one right here is the same thing. And I may have taken it completely out of context, but God brought it into my attention. And I thank my attention to be passed on to you. When the man said this statement, and I may phrase it a little bit different than what it is there. When Jesus asked him, "Do you want to be made well?" And I know that it was probably an excuse. But he made a very pointed statement. He said there was nobody there to help me. Don't miss that thought. There was nobody there to help me. And all of a sudden, God began to point at me and he says, "How many people are around that would like for their life to be changed? How many people are there in your neighborhood that would like to be a part of a church, that would like to have their life changed for the better because they understand there's something in that life that is different? How many people do you work with that needs their life to be changed? And yet, we're there and we don't help." Don't let that slide off of you as it has me so often. this man, and I don't know about the stirring of the water. I don't get into all of that because I know that God could do whatever God wants to do. But there was nobody there that could, that would help him or could help him. Listen, we have people around us every day that needs to know Jesus Christ, the Savior and Lord of their life. We have people that are there every day that needs to be in God's house, that needs to be surrounded by Christian people. We see people every day, whether we're in our neighbors or in our work or whether it's in school or whatever it is, we see people every day that need something. They need Jesus. And God has called us to be there to help them. Just simply put our arm around them sometime. Just simply invite them. Almost every church that I have been in, and I enjoy visiting the people in the church or enjoy visiting the people in the community, and I have been in people's houses, and they say, you know, I've lived here a year, and nobody has come and invited me to church except you. You know, that's true. And sometimes all they want to do is just simply be ask. Sometimes all they need is just simply that little nudge. Sometimes all they need is simply somebody to tell them, listen, I know how God can change your life. And yet, sometimes there's nobody there to help them. God hit me with that this week. And it's been on my mind all week long. I hope it don't leave me, to be perfectly honest with you. Because I hope that I can be that go-between. I hope I can be that priest for them that lets them know about Jesus Christ. Lets them know how much they need Jesus and how much they need the church and how much they need to be in the church. And then there's one other thing out of this. And I probably mentioned it a while ago. Jesus simply said at that point, take up your bed and walk. You see, Jesus was going to heal him, but he had to respond. I got started thinking this morning and kind of comical as I was running through this right here in my mind. It don't say Jesus got in behind him and started lifting him up and say, hey, get up on your feet. Get up on your feet. You're going to be healed. Get up on your feet. He didn't do that. He just simply said, take up your bed and walk. Get up. Move. You see, it doesn't make any difference. Because this is a message to Christians as well as it is to lost people. Because if we're going to serve God, we're going to have to be willing to get up. We're going to have to be willing to move. We're going to have to be willing for God to work through our life and just simply get up and do what God asks us to do. Because, you know, I know one thing this morning, and I don't know a whole lot about you people, and some of you I know very little bit about. But I do know one thing this morning. That as I mentioned that a while ago about somebody in your community or somebody in your work, there's somebody's name popped into your mind. If you're listening to me, and God is speaking, and God is dealing, and I know that God is dealing. Somebody popped into your mind as a Christian Hey, they need to be in church. They need to be here. Maybe God is asking you to just simply go and call them, knock on their door, say, listen, we have a wonderful church. We would love for you to come. If I can pick you up or you come with me, I'll be glad to do that. I also know that if you're not a Christian this morning, God is calling you. I know that. Adrian Rogers said that if you come and you ask Jesus to save you, if he don't, he'll shut his Bible and never preach again. That's true. But God is dealing with your heart if you're not a Christian today. I know that. And when we give this invitation, if you want your life changed, you're going to have to make that step. Now, you don't have to do anything else. This man didn't have to do anything. He just simply got up on his feet. That's all. When Jesus healed somebody, they were healed, and they were healed immediately. But they had to respond. You see, if you're going to come to God, you're going to come to Jesus, you're going to have to respond. I hope you do that this morning. I hope as God is dealing with your heart, whether you're a Christian and God is asking you to be involved in people that are around you, that you say, yes, Lord, I'll do that. If you're lost and God is asking you this morning to have your life completely changed for the best, because you see, people don't understand. Because they think, oh, the world is so satisfying, but the world passes away. And after a while, even the pleasures of the world are not pleasures anymore. But one thing about coming to Jesus Christ, it never ends. Throughout all eternity, it never ends. So we encourage you this morning to just simply respond to what God is calling you to do. Thank you, dear precious Heavenly Father. Thank you so very much today for being my Savior. Thank you so very much today that the Spirit is in this meeting that we're having. And dear precious Heavenly Father, I just pray, as you have spoken, and you have spoken,